Incorruptibles, Liz and Marianne, have come down from San Francisco. So we really, really appreciate your time to give us their presentation. And I believe from the correspondence I received, but I'm sure they'll correct me if I'm wrong, they're really trying to act as a hub for places to be able to connect groups like ours to kind of find out what the motion is of our movement. And so anyways, I'm going to leave it up to Liz.
Yes.
For some reason, I call you Julia, though? I've been trying so hard, like,
sure.
Liz.
That'll be my stage name today.
Also known as Julia.
Neither of them are profitable.
Will be giving us a quick presentation. So as always, let's do our thing and give her lots of love.
Thanks, Kelsey. And I want to first mention I'm here with my colleague, Marianne.
Hey, Marianne.
We're always part of the Incorruptibles, and I really want to thank you for having us, for making the time. You're clearly extremely involved, extremely knowledgeable, and it's a great honor just to be here among you. So as Kelsey said, Marianne and I are from the Incorruptibles. And we are a national organization right now, and also, as you mentioned, Kelsey, hub is a really good way to describe it. We are looking for and seeking to grow grassroots groups that are on the ground that are representing the people in government, because we all know that, unfortunately, for most of our governmental system, people don't represent the people at any level. It's the corporations that are represented. So our ultimate goal is to fill all levels of government with incorruptible leaders. This is our contact information, by the way. I'll put it up here again at the end. This is my cell, so text me, call me. Put it up again. Okay, so as I mentioned, our goal is to get people in to all levels of government. Now, we're very, very focused on local government right now. Why? We feel it's where we can make the most difference, and it's also where we can really listen to the people. As you guys are all doing this already, you're all doing this on the ground, so you know what it is I'm talking about. Trying to get things done at the state level and at the national level in terms of the kinds of goals that really represent what people want and what people need and what's good for the community and to protect the vulnerable. Working on that at the state level and at the national level right now is obviously, as you know, going to be a really uphill battle, because we already have government that just represents the corporations. Both parties represent the corporations. However, if we start at the local level and start to really build a critical mass of people in city councils, and municipalities, and local governments, in case you have heard of the Richmond Progressive Alliance, they're a real success story. They have been able to do that, so we actually are using them as a model in our step-by-step approach to how to create local government that truly represents the people. And also, as you probably know, Richmond is now running candidates up at the state level because they already have a progressive supermajority on their council, which is great. So
we talk about that goals for 80.
Yay! Woo! And get a problem.
Yeah.
So get good people in. And by the way, we're also talking to them and hoping that they will align with us as well. So that's why we're here, in case I didn't mention it, because we're hoping that you guys are working on great goals. You want to represent people. We are the national organization that wants to represent people and to help connect everyone, as well as provide training and guidance for how we can all be successful together. So that's why we're here, basically to ask you to work with us, to work with you, and work together to make good things happen. All right, so getting good people in, we have to, these are necessary but not sufficient aspects of our group, so no corporate money, not dying of corporate money. So exciting. And no party affiliation.
Haven't we? We all voted as a club that this is what our business was going to be about. So we're going to.
I know this is not a really big issue. So let me explain a little bit further. This means that we're post-partisan. It doesn't mean we are anti-party. What it means is that whatever party is most likely to win in your slate of candidates, that's the party that they should run under. So they're going to be an incorruptible candidate. In other words, they emerge from the coalitions that we build on the ground. And they're also running as, like I said, the party that is most likely to win. As you know, state politics, national politics, pretty much impossible if you're not a Republican or a Democrat, or don't have that affiliation. However, you probably also know at the local level, it's very possible to win as an independent. Richmond has had a two-party Green mayor, Bernie Sanders was independent for almost his whole career, right?
So our very own mayor and MVP, so it happens.
There you go.
Also the first female mayor, also the first Chinese American mayor, but I'm bragging now about the amazing low-key progressiveness.
That's great. Getting more thrilled about being here. I appreciate it. All right, so first up in accomplishing our goal is to listen. Go to where the people are. Go to where the constituents are. Who do you want to represent? You want to represent everybody, 99%, right? Because right now all of our money that we work for and all of our productivity just races up to the top, to the 1%. So how do we represent those who are actually working to make our country happen, right? We are the many, they are the few. We have to remember that. That just means that we have to go to where they are. We're all busy. People are working. People have school. People are parents. So, you know, go to the PTA meetings, go to the churches, go to the senior centers, the community centers, the, you know, where workers are, union meetings. Whoever you want to represent, which really means everybody, especially the vulnerable, that's the first step, is going to them and listening to them and asking specific questions. So that's first. The next step is to build coalitions. One of the thinkers that we really base our philosophies on, you may have heard of her, her name is Jane McAlevey. She most recently came out with a book called No Shortcuts. She's a worker organizer. She's had a lot of success, and she has a lot of experience also and a lot of really important thoughts around how to find what she calls organic leaders in these different areas that I just mentioned. So when you go out and talk to people, teachers, let's say, or nurses, or workers. Who are the, and ask them, you know, who are the leaders in your group? You know, who are the ones that you think are, you know, really care and are really working for you? And as we start to build coalitions and work together, and those leaders start to emerge, then we start to see who the candidates are. Then run candidates. So what we, I don't have really any experience in politics.
Perfect.
But my
sense to the club.
My sense is good. So a lot of real people working together. My sense is that sometimes the way this process is thought of is like, let's find a good person. Who's the right person? And now let's build the group around the person. We kind of do it the other way around. Let's build the group first. Let's find out what's really important to the community. You know, like rent control. There's just move out that path. And let the leaders emerge from that. So it's flipped. Repeat, because we're probably gonna lose before we win. I mean, maybe not, but probably. So what happens when you have a lot of energy focused around a single person is that, let's say they're not successful, all of the intellectual capital around the campaigns, all of, you know, the whole organization just kind of dissipates, goes away. But if you start with a coalition, all of the knowledge and the experience and the work that went into that and the organizing, you know, stays within the organization. One of the things that we provide training and guidance on is continuous town halls. So not just during election years, but it's about always going out to where the people are and asking them, you know, not just open-ended questions of like, what do you need, but, you know, very specific things like, how much student debt are you going to have when you graduate college? Or, you know, how long do you think it's going to take you to pay it off? Or how long have you been out of a job? Or, you know, things like that, specific questions so that you can really find out what's important to people and what kind of work needs to be done. So that's the repeat part. Okay, I'm almost done.
It's good.
It's good. Yeah. So that's really like the important part of what I have my cheat sheet here. You know, what we're really offering to you is providing training and answering questions on like how this gets done, right? So your next question is, Liz, this sounds great. How do we do it, right? So we provide guidance and training in that. how to run, how to form these coalitions, how to run. If you say, I'm going to go talk to the PTA next week. What do I do? How do I run this meeting? So we can help you with that. Our director, our fearless leader, Anna Callahan, who is the first person that connected with Helen. Yes, she's very inspiring. She and I actually go back a long way, and we used to work together. We know each other from Boston. We both totally by coincidence ended up in the same part of the world, so it's really great to work with her. Yes. Anyway.
We're in Boston.
Okay, we'll have to talk about that later.
This one right here.
Okay. All right. I lived there 12 years, so yeah.
I was one.
Wow. Okay.
Forged by it.
Yeah, that is some serious environment to be forged in. So, not for the faint of heart. So anyway, Anna is, as we speak, the reason why she's not here is that she is in Minnesota at the Wellstone organization, which you may have heard of, which is known for providing excellent campaign training to progressive candidates. So she's there assimilating and absorbing all of that information and just, you know, getting spring-loaded and ready to share that with all of you. So let's see, what else did I want to say? Yes, we are, I think I already mentioned this, but we're a decentralized hub and spoke model, allowing grassroots groups to network, share ideas, methodology, solutions. One of the things that we use that I actually find is really helpful in our national team, which, by the way, I think I didn't mention, but we have some people in New York and Omaha, and people getting ready to start grassroots groups in Omaha, which is really exciting. But we are all on this messaging system called Rocket Chat, which is private. And I don't know if any of you use Slack, but it's pretty much the same thing, except it's private. People can't hack into it. Don't ask me the specifics of that, but there are good reasons why we're on that and not on Slack, so that our stuff can't be leaked out there. That wasn't very helpful, sorry. So anyway, we find Rocket Chat extremely useful for that kind of idea exchange. Okay, so now we really want to get to know you. So we have some questions for you, and anybody can answer. And
then, I'm here.
The spokesperson. And then after that, we'd be happy to take questions. So what groups are in your coalition, your fun coalition, or are allied with your coalition?
So right now, our area, Union City, Newark, and Fremont, they're not exactly political hotspots.
Okay.
The Democratic clubs are a little too established for our precinct.
Sorry, time out a second. I don't mean political groups.
Other groups.
Anybody.
Can we stand up for Fremont?
Yeah, I was going to say, we have a lot of community groups. So in our bylaws, we are nonpartisan because we want to create an environment that encourages Green Party members to run. We have two people here that were endorsed by that party, even though they're Democrats. So we have that. We have a lot of alliances. We have like a Universal Unitarian Church in town that does a lot of really good progressive work, and they're always interested in us without showing up, which I understand. I don't go to their certain places. They're all great. I think we have a little bit of isolation in this area just because there is not a ton of activism in our little corner of the world here. The Rise Coalition, which we've allied with over housing justice, is a big one. And
Protect Nile.
There's a vote,
of course. Everybody should be an ally of a vote. They're the only people doing anything about housing, in my opinion. Habitat for Humanity also started a project, and I believe that a lot of us went to their So what we're looking for really is regional specific allies that want to provide healthcare, housing, humanity to people.
Right.
So unfortunately, we just live in an area that is not a hot spot for those types of activities, and we're going to carry the torch into making it a hot spot of those types of activities. That's our mission.
Right. So what we're saying is that we should be working on that as well as going to regular people where they are. Teachers, nurses, seniors, people of color, whoever, wherever you can go out where people are already gathered. So don't wait for them to be activists. Because what is this about? This is about representing people. So we have to go out and find where people are and, by the way, get them engaged. So this is a process by which we can start to represent the people, but it is also a process by which we can get the people engaged. Instead of waiting for the oh, this is an activist group, I want to, let's go out and talk to regular people that are busy, that work, that aren't activists yet, and ask them specific questions about what is your life like, what are you struggling with, and get them engaged with, hey, did you know that if we listen to enough of you and start to find the organic leaders and start to create platforms that really work for you, you can actually make a difference in how your community is run. So that's what we're talking about. We're going to that level deeper.
Just this last Monday, we had Meet a Muslim event here.
Great.
Right here in the facility.
Yes. Great.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah.
Well, that was very informative.
Yeah.
And it was a lot of give and take, and information was shared, and that would be one of the things we're talking about here.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. Great.
Also, the senior centers, you know, Fremont and Newark, those are very good places to talk and speak about it, make a presentation on that.
Make a presentation, but also.
Big community.
And they vote.
Fremont, its own senior center, and then Newark has its own senior center.
Yeah, but what's
and
important.
So Union City.
Very good.
But
and
what's
important. Yeah, and Union City.
But what's important is that we listen first. So I know I'm here talking to you, but what I think is important is that we first listen and ask questions rather than say, this is who we are, join us. You know, that's kind of what I'm doing today. But you know what I'm saying? Yeah, go ahead.
I've also been doing it in the opposite direction that these guys. They've been very Fremont, pulling people into Fremont. I've actually been going out, I belong to the Voting Rights Task Force, Ballots for Bernie, California Election Integrity Coalition. I recently joined RPA. I've actually been invited to Peninsula Democrats. I've also been invited to Indivisible Silicon Valley. So, I'm actually working in the opposite direction because if we can't keep on people here, we might as well bring people in. And I think some of my issues are also more statewide and nationally.
Well, you live in Newark. So
I also live in Newark.
There's not much going on.
The deadest place in the world.
I'm sure people work there. There are workers. People have jobs or not.
People have jobs. Newark
had to raise their sales tax to 10% because they don't have enough revenue, because they don't have enough businesses, because they build houses everywhere. So
that's not why. That's to pay for the new library and the new civic center.
You're right. Nitro GG.
Right. Well, and is that what the people want?
No.
So we have work to do, and we have to go find them and invite them to become more engaged and to.
But I do back on Allison's point that a lot of members, but go out to other groups outside Margaret, of course, but that doesn't overall solve the issue of identifying regular people's problems. That just gets you more down to the.
But it makes me
rabbit hole.
It's all good energy if we put it out there. I mean, I know that everybody here cares a lot and is working hard to make life better for regular people. So it's all good stuff. Yes?
Yeah, I was going to say, Fremont is a tough nut to crack. I mean, not to be pessimistic, but there's not a lot. I know when I first started going, we looked at, what are the various organizations? And we were like, don't bother. Because you have to understand, it is definitely a sleepy bedroom suburb. Most of the people that work in high tech, I know what that's like. Your life is your work and your family, you don't have to do much else.
Yep.
Do you even understand what's going on? What we found, so it was very tough to get into the PTA and some other organizations. But what we did, which we found effective, was just doing the grocery stores.
Awesome! Yeah! Great
and
idea!
My wonderful lawyer wife,
yeah.
We found out that the Pruneyard decision is to do so. And she was arguing with lucky managers and we have a right to be here. We've actually found that quite effective.
Yeah.
Because what I found that really nice about it is most people don't care. Most people look at you as a weirdo or whatever. So but they walk away, and then our
not an accident. You know, as you know, for the past 40 or 50 years, the people who have been controlling the government, which is beholden to the corporation, has been working very hard to try to make sure we're disengaged. And because while we're not paying attention, they can take all our money, right? So we have to, that's why I keep saying we have to invite people in and not say, hey, I'm running for office, help me. We have to say, where are you coming from? You know, let's get this stuff addressed. Yeah, go ahead.
I have a question. What about the churches here?
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Tri-City Ecumenical.
You know, not just Christian, but non-denominational and the Indian and the Chinese
sure.
congregations.
Great.
Have those been looked at as political? Some of them may have social justice committees or other activist committees within embedded in their organizations. Does anybody know about that here?
I'm part of the interface religious organization, the Fremont community.
The Interfaith Council?
It's an interface organization.
Okay.
They're strictly for prayer, spirituality. So, but they're in this community. So I'm part of that organization. But that includes a whole lot of people. So that's a good place to start and talk to people.
You know, the Tri-City Interfaith Council?
Yeah.
Tri-City Interfaith Council, right.
Yeah, we have, just so you know, I mean, Fremont is remarkably diverse, mm-hmm. not just ethnically,
yeah,
but religiously.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a very good organization, the Tri-City Interfaith Council,
great.
That has, you know, puts on a few events.
Right.
But it really is remarkable, the diversity we have there in Fremont.
Yeah. They don't only go to the church spirituality, they're involved with community organizations.
Yeah.
So that would be an ideal organization to bring in people like us to talk about, you know, our goals and for their livelihood, what's beneficial to their livelihood.
Yeah, they actually do a honking wave on Thursday every month at the Sale Padre in Maori. They do like a peace and love honking wave to promote unity. Quite a little crowd shows up. I love going when I can. It's nice. I feel like quite a few people who I see there are people who have come to Fun Progressive meetings and that we've a little bit alienated to our politics. So it's a little bit of a tough crowd, but I still support that 100%. And I understand if people want to be upset because we're rebels who break ranks.
Kelsey, I'd like just a shout out. Dottie Nygaard, the future congresswoman from CD10, is now watching.
Oh, great.
Hi. 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 Hello.
Great. Thanks for joining us.
Okay,
so, yeah, okay.
I was going to say flea markets, not
flea markets.
Farmers. We've been doing a lot of those for SB 562. Helen has taken the charge on that. And I have to say, the good thing about campaigning for SB 562 is that this is a bill that they wrote to protect everyone that lives in California, even if you're not a legal citizen. And a lot of people Helen and I spoke with are like, oh, I'm not a citizen. And we were like, guess what? It doesn't matter because this covers you too.
You live in California.
Yeah, and you pay your taxes here, like you're going to get it. And so I think it's been really helpful to have legislation that includes people who can't vote because they still deserve an active voice in our citizenry. And that is a great way to help bring them into it, is to have more legislation that includes everybody. Everybody.
Exactly. So really quick to reiterate, that's a little farther down the road in our process after you listen to everybody. So what we would advise, all of this is extremely important as well. What we would also advise is to go to a farmer's market and say, we want to hear from you. This is where the town hall is. We want to hear from you. If you're not a citizen, we want to hear from you. You know, these are the issues. Maybe you say these are the issues that we're going to talk about. And then from there, figure out who the leaders are and the issues are. And that's the next step. Go ahead.
I really like what you're saying, but I have to say that after spending a few years here in Fremont, I've become a little disillusioned, because sometimes when you just ask people what their issues are, the things they say can be a little bit upsetting.
Yeah.
Like, there's too many Chinese people moving into the
sure.
city, or they're building too much housing.
Yeah.
We don't need any more housing.
run these town halls and very specific questions. I gave a few examples. I'm not super up on them yet. We are right now writing the training for that, but they're very specific, like, how are you doing with, like, affording your housing? Or how much, like I was saying before, how much debt are you going to have when you finish school? You know, do you think you're going to be
able
to...
What
is your health insurance deductible? This is an aside. I work in health insurance. I'm an employee benefits consultant for a small business in the Bay Area. And so I actually talk to the medical insurers every day and try to get them to do at least what they said they were doing in their contract. But anyway, we can have a beer later and I can tell you all about that. But I'm really glad you brought that up because yes, it is a very specific slate of questions. It isn't like, oh, tell us whatever you want. Yeah, it's not. So thank you.
So you want to ask more personal questions than what their rights are.
Right. We don't just go in and say, oh, what do you think the problem is? Yeah, very specific questions. And again, I don't have that script in front of me right now, but that is something that we will have ready for.
As a suggestion, another thing that I think should be in that script, if you have with the upper management, is how much would having guaranteed child care help your wife?
Sure.
Or how much would it help your wife to have trusted domestic help? We use Nextdoor a lot in our community.
Oh, yeah.
And a lot of people on Nextdoor are always looking for child care, domestic services like cooking and cleaning and things like that.
And
elder care, things like that. You know, and so often in our community, we find that there isn't enough funding for people to use like MFLA to care for an elderly person. There isn't guaranteed child care, pre-K child care.
Right.
You know, parents spend $600, $700 a week sometimes to have their kids looked after. And so I think that those are really good topics that people would agree should be socialized, that we can present without saying, we're going to socialize. So
right.
You can get that to upper management, put it in your script.
We don't really have upper management.
I know, I need upper management.
I mean, we do have a director, but we are very decentralized, and we do go by service leadership and radical creative diversity. We want people to it means that we want people to come up with ideas and contribute them and run with their ideas, and we also have team leader evaluations every month, so we make sure that our team leads are really servicing the people that are working in their group. As long as something is aligned with the mission, we really want people to be able to have ownership of their project, because actually we believe that's the only way to have a successful movement.
I wanted to add something. There's a professor,
yep.
He's now retired from Berkeley, his name is William Lakoff, that has studied about neurolinguistics, about language, and why Trump and his ilk are succeeding. Is they talk about values and, in fact, convince people to vote against their own self-interest because he's appealing to their values. And there's a large segment of our population that are daddy-oriented or father-oriented, and they want a strong daddy to tell them what to do. But we need, I think what I like about coalition building and listening is that rather than being so programmatic, we want this thing, we want this thing, we want this thing, I think we find a set of common core values. And then we can have disagreements about how we get there. But as long
exactly.
as we're listening to each other,
exactly.
then we begin to have empathy, and the people that we're talking to will feel heard. I think so many people do not feel like they're being heard, they're being talked to,
right.
they're being condescended to, and we need to uplift that discussion and bring it to a new plane. So we have a set of values that are consistent with people's self-interest.
Okay. That's exactly it. Yeah, thank you for contributing that, and I wrote it down. So
we live streamed it.
Woohoo! Yes, I will also be watching this later, but I don't know. I'm a compulsive note taker.
And then you'll be like,
tell me.
I have another question. That is, speaking of the technical street, has there been outreach to cultivate these kinds of coalition relationships with any of the technical streets?
Right.
Yeah. And because I know that I'm from Seattle, I just moved down. Right.
But you're asking specific to companies, right? Like, has anyone reached out to Facebook, Tesla? Maybe if I was a city council member in Fremont, I might write them an email.
Exactly. I mean, to actually, you know, nurture and take advantage of any outreach programs that they might have, whether it be a lunchtime program where they invite in speakers, if you know if they have any of those programs available to their employees, that sort of thing.
Interesting.
Okay.
I come from AT&T. We're the largest corporation.
Let's take it back to let's take it back to the people.
Think about that because their laws already established corporate.
Right.
Right. It's
hard because we really do need to learn how to frame our issues more as moral human issues rather than political issues, and that's something all of us have encountered trying to, you know, find space to be able to promote ourselves or talk about our issues or whatever. If people are like, oh, we don't want politics here.
Exactly.
Okay, well, guess what? Your healthcare isn't really politics. It's your epic healthcare. You know, your minimum wage is not really politics. It's like your epic minimum wage. Like, what is the bare minimum we're allowed to let people work for? And we are so bad at framing it that way and, like, stuff. I really think that collectively what all these groups need to do is decide that we're not going to make it political, we're going to make it people-litical.
I like that.
Beautiful.
People-litical.
The only way you can go through that is through human resources in the corporate world.
Yeah,
and
so...
You go through it, open people, attitude...
We should start taking over the HR and the corporation.
Yeah, but human resources for the window would be an opportunity.
It's great because I seem to have touched off a very rich... brainstorming session. So that's great, and I definitely want to encourage that, but I also don't want to take up your whole evening. So let me just go through like the last couple of questions that I have. We are all about like town halls, being on the ground, getting in touch with, again, residents, and also knocking on every door. So I don't know if you guys have heard of knock every door. This not just the people that are already aligned with what we think is right, but also people that may not agree with us. So have you guys done any town halls or any knock at every door activities?
By town hall, do you mean we just have our own town hall, not the Congress?
We've done candidate forums, and we have a
like open to the public.
We have two city council members here tonight who have participated in voting and everything. So we definitely try. Politicians here are easy to engage. It's more of the public that would be nice to pull into the spectrum.
Great. So that pretty much answers my question, because I think you could really use some help with pulling the public in, and that's what
base
we're
building,
doing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we did a lot of barnstorms for the brain campaign, our group. Yes.
And can you
barnstorming?
What is that?
Well, we did.
It was a town hall.
We could get all the community room in the library, somebody's backyard.
Oh, great.
We could invite people to come and
support the
campaign. Volunteers and stuff like that. We had some huge groups.
Yeah. 7,800 people.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
After he did not get the nomination, a lot of people did drop out because that was their, main focus. But there are people that, like this group is basically from...
We started out as a Fremont Fund for Bernie.
Yeah. And so a lot of people come around. We've got their information, so we can email them. And
that's amazing.
Yeah.
So you must have a huge contact list.
Yeah,
that you can.
It's about 250.
Wow.
Yeah,
congratulations.
And not to brag too much, but I think Ro Khanna, our congressman, probably does more town halls than any other congressman in the United States. He literally does one every month, and he's been doing it in every city.
That's great. Yeah. So we gotta pack him in.
Yeah. No, I mean, we can't even get into them. We show up, and they're like, yeah, you guys are good. We've already talked to you.
You're the regular.
We need the new people.
Now he's still drawing 700,000-800,000 people.
Yeah.
Every single time.
How many?
700,000 people, depending on the location.
Wow.
The next one's going to be in Sunnyvale. I bet that one's packed.
Oh, yeah.
That's amazing. Yeah. That's great that he's got that connection to his constituents. That's probably not something that's very common.
Mm.
So that's wonderful. So I think another place where the Incorruptibles is aligned with what you guys are doing is that we also are a home for burning people. Our founder, Anna Callahan, she quit her software engineering job to organize burning a couple years back. Yeah. So we're feeling it. We know that this is real. We know that there are more of us than there are of them. You know what I'm saying? And so we got to get this done. Yes?
So just a question for you. I know I was in a meeting where a number of Bernie people were talking, the Bernie Crafts, as we officially call
ourselves.
We're talking about actually forming a statewide organization.
Uh-huh.
I'm wondering if you're aligned with that or.
I can't say that I know anything about that
yet. It's very infantile what they're talking about. But I mean, my understanding is that you have a lot of revolution at the national level.
Mm-hmm.
But at that point, that simply cannot filter down to even state races, let alone local races. So they're trying to establish something at the state level. And one final question for you. Do you have meetings in San Francisco? Or?
We meet. So if you join our national team, which I would encourage you to do, you can sign up on our website, theincorruptibles.us. There's a big button that says join us. By the way, I didn't get to mention this. There's also a button where you can download our step-by-step guide. It's based on the Richmond Progressive Alliance successful process in how to do grassroots organizing and really make your town better for everyone, which they did. So if you join us, we have meetings every week, and there you can dial in. We're very oriented that way. We want to be able to include everybody literally all over the country. So a lot of us are here in the Bay, but as I said before, we've got New York, Omaha, some other places. So
I work in San Francisco, so we need to try.
If you're going to be in the neighborhood, our meetings are in Berkeley, actually.
Oh.
So
hmm.
I live in San Francisco, so it's a little bit of a schlep, but it's nice to see people in person when I can. So
do you have a connection by phone? How do you connect by phone?
So it's actually really, really easy. It's a link.
Okay.
If you have Google, which okay, you actually just click on it. And then it says join, and you can join. yeah. And if you, because I'm somebody that's not, I need moral support sometimes with those kinds of things. So I'm happy to pay it forward. I probably talked way too long, so I'm going to let you guys go. But our call to action here is that we really hope you want to align with us. We think it will be synergistic if we can get together. I think we're working on a lot of the same goals. And like I said, we can help you with some really concrete methodology on how to get out there and bring more of the public in. So thank you. Thanks for having us.
I appreciate your letting me lurk, because I'm just very recently become involved with the Incorruptibles, and thank you, Liz, for allowing me to be here. It's really impressive to see the work that you're all doing. The active, intelligent engagement that you have. And I can really see a lot of ways in which, as I understand, as I'm beginning to understand what the Incorruptibles is about, that there's a real good alliance. There's a real good potential for great alliance here, so that the kinds of things that we can offer, I'm particularly interested in the incredible inequality financially that's happened.
Yeah.
And so how I'm hoping to plug into the group is getting information to people about where it's come from,
mm-hmm.
and what to do about it.
Mm-hmm.
So just to give you a little, just a little, sort of a little teaser, some of you may know something about the Bank of Oakland that people have been working on. So this is a particularly strong interest that I have, and something that I'm hoping to bring. And when Liz was talking about radical
creative diversity,
that's sort of a way that so what radical creative diversity is about, I can really see and hear as you're all talking,
yeah.
and you've come up one after another to talk about what things really turn you on, what lights a fire. And that's really what the Incorruptibles is about. That's what brings me, aligned me very strongly with the organization. So that's personally what I hope to bring. But again, I can see that within you. And we talk about, within the national team, about, working, creating coalitions. It was great to hear you talking about potential, coalition building that you can do within the organization. It'd be great to be able to help you with that process. And anyway, so I don't want to babble on long.
Excellent.
Thank you very much.
Thank you both.
Yeah, I was telling Liz before the meeting started, I was raised Catholic, so the Incorruptibles to me is like the group of saints that came together and decided that they were better than the gold shillings or whatever it was back then. So, and